welcome to Catholic Answers Live, and more importantly, Merry Christmas to you as we continue with our Christmas season programming. And we're just so grateful that you would join us during this Christmas season. Anybody who's joining us maybe for the first time, because you don't usually get the opportunity to tune in at this time of day, welcome. We're delighted to have you. Catholic Answers provides this program, makes this program. And if you want to find out more about the Apostolate Catholic Answers, you can just visit us at Catholic.com. That's not hard to remember, Catholic.com. I don't know why we did it, but we waited until the second to last day of the year to do my favorite show of the year. We haven't even done it yet, and I'm already convinced this is my favorite show of the year. Our good friend Steve Weidenkopf, who's a lecturer in history at Christendom College Graduate School of Theology in Alexandria, has a brand new book out. As a matter of fact, Christmas Day was its release date, and the book is called The Church and the Middle Ages, Cathedrals, Crusades, and the Papacy in Exile. It's about the years between the year 1000 and the year 1378. First of all, Steve Weidenkopf, thank you for being with us.
Thanks, Si. Thanks for having me on the show again. Glad to be here, and Merry Christmas to you.
Yeah, Merry Christmas to you. Thank you. I am convinced that the entire modern history of the world involves a giant act of propaganda. And that act of propaganda goes like this. The Middle Ages was backwards, dark, dingy, and horrible. And then a new light dawned, and we got the modern world. Everything's a massive oversimplification. But how far off am I with that?
No, I don't think you're too far off on that side, really. I mean, that is pretty true. I mean, you know, and I cover that sentiment in the book. I mean, that really is what people think of the Middle Ages or the word medieval. I mean, that's the immediate, mental picture that people get. You know, dark, brutish, bloody, violent, full of, you know, religious zealots or superstitions and things like that. And that's pretty much how that time period is usually portrayed in the media and Hollywood and things like that as well.
Steve is the author of a whole bunch of books, including Timeless, A History of the Catholic Church, The Real Story of Catholic History. He has a book on the Reformation, a 20 Answers booklet with us on the Reformation. He wrote The Glory of the Crusades. He wrote Epic, A Journey Through Church History. And now we have the new book, The Church and the Middle Ages, Cathedrals, Crusades, and the Papacy in Exile. And this is why I say this is one of my favorite, I know this is going to be one of my favorite shows of the year, is that I think one of the things that would help people in the modern world is a more honest telling of history. We'd know our place in the world better if we had a more honest telling of history. I assume, looking at your list of books, that you would agree with that.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. So, I mean, I've dedicated a bit of, you know, my work and my focus of my work on trying to do that, right, to present an authentic understanding of history of these, you know, previous centuries in a way that is accessible to people. So it's not just, for academics or whatnot, but for more popular, wider audience. And in a way that really, again, gets back to what I think is the emphasis the original kind of focus of history, which is the telling of stories, right? Narrative approach, which doesn't mean that obviously what you're telling is not true, like it's made up or fiction or something. That's not what I mean by story or narrative, but that's really what, you know, presenting history as the human drama it is, right? Full of heroes and villains and you know, although complex people, as Catholics, we understand, right, that everyone is a fallen yet redeemed creature and given free will. And sometimes, you know, people act in accordance with virtue and in accordance with their calling and their vocation, and sometimes they don't. And even at the highest levels of the church, for example. So, and as a Catholic historian in particular, we don't want to shy away from that. We're not presenting some kind of whitewashed, picture perfect presentation of the church's history. You have to present it warts and all, but you explain it in the context in which the people lived. And that's what I tried to do really in this recent book, in an age, as we talked about, that is so easily misunderstood and mischaracterized.
Yeah, and I appreciate that, because what you just said in part, Steve, because I imagine I'm probably guilty of this sometimes. The tendency is to say modern historians, and not even just modern historians, but modern storytellers, people who make movies and television shows and write novels and that kind of thing, are so unfair to the people of the Middle Ages, particularly, the Christian people, let's be honest, the Christian people of the Middle Ages, that you want to just defend them. And but if you do that in a way that doesn't admit, yeah, there was a lot of the shady stuff that went on there, then you're committing the same act just in reverse, kind of.
Yeah, absolutely. And you know, it's one thing I talk about in the book too, is just, you know, I think one of the reasons why people in the modern world tend to struggle with this period of time is one way, or one reason, is because of the way it's been taught in our educational environment is one thing, but and presented, as we've talked about, in the media and Hollywood, but also because our modern world is so significantly different from the world of the medieval period, right, of the Middle Ages. In terms of what I mean by that is it's really two different things that that we in the modern world struggle with, right? The medieval world, or the medieval worldview, was very hierarchical, right? Medieval society was hierarchical, it was authoritative, right? Democracy as a political institution and as a bedrock of a society or of a nation like we have in the United States just didn't exist. There was a hierarchy, and people understood that hierarchy, and they kind of accepted that hierarchy, if you will. It was enforced by societal norms and values, and it imbued every area of life, especially politically, except for, interestingly enough, the church, right? The church was the one area of medieval life where someone could advance regardless of who they were and where they came from. And that was not true of secular society, right? If you were born a serf, you were the son of a serf, very rare would you ever amount to anything more than that in medieval society, unless you entered the church. And if you entered the church as a son of a serf, but you were smart, you dedicated your life to service and to living a holy life, you could advance. Up to you could be an abbot, you could be a bishop, you could even,
Wow,
get
yeah.
to the highest levels of the church's office. So there's that. And then the other aspect is just what we've been talking about, the faith aspect of the Middle Ages, right? Modern man has such a difficulty understanding that one's life would be so infused with the faith, from the time you woke up to the time you went to bed, that's what medieval man, that's what the medieval world was about. It was imbued with the Catholic faith, and we just don't really appreciate that as much, or if at all, in the modern world, frankly.
We're talking about the Middle Ages this hour, and the occasion for this conversation, one that I have been looking forward to, is the publication of the new book, The Church and the Middle Ages: Cathedrals, Crusades, and the Papacy in Exile. The author is Steve Weidenkopf. You can find all about Steve at his website, steveweidenkopf.com. Steve, as I said earlier, is a lecturer in church history at Christendom College Graduate School of Theology in Alexandria, Virginia. We probably should take a quick break, but one of the things you focus on in the book is misconceptions about this period of history. Can we do some major misconceptions when we come back, Steve?
Absolutely, would love to.
All right, let's do that. We'll focus on some misconceptions about the Middle Ages with Steve Weidenkopf right after this on Catholic Answers Live.
Stay with us for more Catholic Answers Live.
Hi, this is Cy Kellett. Don't forget to check out the latest episode of our podcast, Catholic Answers Focus. You can listen each week to the world's premier podcast on Catholic apologetics at CatholicAnswersFocus.com or subscribe wherever you get your podcasts. Catholic Answers Focus, now available at CatholicAnswersFocus.com.
Are you a coffee drinker? If so, you can now enjoy a coffee roasted to perfection by the Carmelite monks of Wyoming. Delicious mystic monk coffee is roasted and prepared by monks in a hidden cloistered monastery and is available in over 25 varieties. All mystic monk coffees are works of perfection and labors of love. For more information on how to purchase mystic monk coffee, visit mysticmonkcoffee.com. That's mysticmonkcoffee.com.
She is one of the most beloved saints of all time, honored as the saint of the little way.
Matthew Bunsen and the Doctors of the Church.
Saint Thérèse of Lisieux entered the Carmelite convent of Lisieux in 1888 and survived only 9 more years. Still, her extraordinary holiness and prayer life prompted her superiors to have her write an autobiography, The Story of a Soul. It became a spiritual classic.
For more about the Doctors of the Church, visit doctorsofthechurch.com.
Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live. Merry Christmas to you. Thanks for being with us. Steve Weidenkopf is our guest. He's got a brand new book. He's got a whole bunch of great history books, but you can just check out his section at Amazon to see. But he's got a brand new one now. It just came out this week, The Church in the Middle Ages, Cathedrals, Crusades, and the Papacy in Exile. We said before we went to the break, Steve, we'll take a look at some misconceptions about this period of history. Before we look at the misconceptions, I noticed the dates on your book are 1000 to 1378. I usually think of the Middle Ages as longer than that. This is like the middle of the Middle Ages.
Yeah, exactly, Si. I mean, it's, you know, that, and that's a debate even within the own academic community about what, what really are the Middle Ages and how do you, what years do you define them? Generally, there's some acceptance, you know, 500 to 1500 kind of around there, although that's a massively unwieldy amount of time. But yeah, but this age, in my book, I guess one would consider like the High Middle Ages. That would be the more sub, you know, greater subdivision of the time period, if you will.
And so after, why 1378? What happens in 13? Or did you just get tired and you stopped writing there? Or I assume there's something that happened in 1378 and you said, that's it, a plague on the rest of this. I'll just go from there.
Yeah, that's a great, that's a great question. I had the, I had my 14th century dartboard up, and I just, you know, threw the dart and it landed on 1378. No, I stopped it there. Well, so first of all, I should say, right, that this book is one in a series that Ave Maria Press is doing on reclaiming Catholic history. So there's seven volumes, and obviously I couldn't, you know, cover all of it. I had to cover a specific period of time, but I chose 1378 specifically for this to end because that's when you have the end of the Avignon papacy. That's the time period when we had the popes actually living in Avignon in the south of France. They were not resident in Rome anymore. They were still the Bishop of Rome, just not living there. So it's in 1378, principally through the actions of St. Catherine of Siena, that they return to Rome. And then more bad things follow actually after that. But I had to end the story somewhere. And I figured, you know, coming back to Rome and ending this, this century, the 14th century, which was really a crisis in the papacy itself with the Avignon papacy and other things that followed and all kinds of ecclesiastical abuses going on at the time in the church, that was a good marker to just kind of end the story and let the next author pick up from there.
And by you invoke the term the High Middle Ages, that does give us a sense really of the truth about this period, which is it's a very high period of culture. And there does come some decline after that. But this is a very high period for culture in Europe.
Yeah, very true. I mean, this is, you know, you begin to see, especially towards the end of this period in the 14th century, the kind of, you know, initial, you know, proto-Italian Renaissance type of artists, you know, Giotto and people like that, that are alive and doing some fascinating artistic things with frescoes and other, you know, medium, in especially in Italy. But even more so, you know, in other parts of Europe, of Christendom, especially in France, this is the period of the Gothic cathedrals, right? Or as some architectural historians might refer to it as the French style rather than Gothic, because Gothic was a kind of a negative connotation associated with it or given to it. But yeah, you know, this these massively large cathedrals, which we still see today, which we still cherish today, you know, the Cathedral of Notre Dame, the Cathedral at Chartres, you know, all these other various magnificent structures built for the glory of God, you know, were really the cultural and artistic achievement of this time period, that's for sure.
Okay, so let's talk about some of the misconceptions about this period, about the Middle Ages. You picked out nine of them for the book, but what would you like to share with people of major misconceptions about what was going on during this period?
Yeah, well, you know, I think one that comes to mind easily, and it's the first one I address actually in the book, is were serfs slaves? You know, what's the distinction between a serf and a slave? Many people, when they hear serfs or peasants, they really have this sense of, you know, these were individuals who were really no better than slaves, right? I mean, it was kind of a status that was, you know, slavery, it, you know, that we akin to like what slavery was like in the 19th century or something like that, especially in the United States. But when you look at the serfs, you know, and these group of people in the Middle Ages, that's not true at all. They were, as I mentioned, medieval society was very class-oriented, class-stratified. It was very hierarchical. And you had people at the bottom of medieval society, if you will, that were peasants, serfs, as we would call them as well. But there's a distinction between them. There were non-free serfs and there were free serfs, right? There were non-free peasants and free peasants. So your status really wasn't determined on whether you were a peasant or not. It was, as being a peasant, were you free? Were you unfree? What do I mean by that? Well, when you were an unfree peasant or an unfree serf, what that meant was you had to farm land that was not your own. You had to take care of land that was not your own. You had to take care of the demesne, it was called, or the land that was owned by someone else, usually by a lord, right, by a nobleman. You were also given a small plot of your own land to be able to serve or farm and to provide for your family from. And that small piece of land that you had was actually yours. And so unlike slaves, serfs actually, even unfree serfs, actually owned property. They owned their own land. And that land could be then given to their heirs, right? So, the father dies, he could hand on that land to any sons that he had so that they could provide for themselves and keep that land, so to speak, in the family. Free serfs or free peasants were different, right? They can farm their own land. They didn't have to spend any of their time farming the land of lords or noblemen, and they could do other things as well. They could have other vocations as we would see them. They could be a blacksmith or some kind of trade or whatnot. So serfs had a right to a family as well. As I mentioned, they could pass property on to their family, and they even had times of great rest. Medieval society was organized and structured by the church's liturgical year. And so on solemnities and great feast days, especially, local saints or regional saints, you would have the day off from labor. So, one historian has estimated that, of the 365 days in a year, medieval serfs had about 100 days off from work because of the church's liturgical calendar and her feast days. So that's a very great distinction of these people from what we know and what we understand as modern day slavery or more recent slavery.
So then what would they do on these feast days? Like, was it pleasant? I mean, they have fairs and things, or was it all in church?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, no, there were big parties, usually big festivals associated with these, with feast days. So, obviously the main event, if you will, would be the liturgy, attending mass, at the local, at your church or even at the cathedral if you lived close near one, and celebrate mass for that saint's day. And then afterwards there would be games and parties and lots of different food, and you might have some traveling minstrels come to town, or some comic troupes, or other kinds of entertainers, if you will, and it would be a time of just great relaxation, rest, and fun.
So that it does sound humane in like a humane. I mean, there's a lot of people today that would like to have 100 days off a year. I mean, people work themselves to the bone in the modern world, but think of medieval people as living in a much harsher work environment.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, it was, people, serfs, peasants, they did work, backbreaking work. So, I mean, it was heavy labor. It was agricultural work. Obviously you had animals who could help you with that kind of work as well. But yeah, it was difficult work, not like us sitting at desks, with computers and things like that, as many people do today. So, but yeah, it was hard. But so when you had those days off, that was, that was definitely a way in which you could understand rest, right? Because you didn't have to have that hard work. You could spend time with your family. You could do things with the kid. The kids didn't have to work. Your wife didn't have to work as hard either, kind of thing. And so it was a time for more family environment and family events as well.
So what other misconceptions do we have about this period?
Well, you know, another one that I cover in this book, but I also cover it in the book that I wrote on the Crusades, is about the Crusades and why were Crusaders motivated to go on these armed expeditions, on these armed pilgrimages? And one of the major myths that people believe about the Crusades, which you still see and hear all the time in the modern world, is that they went because of land. They went because of money, because of greed. There was this old myth that was taught in academics, or I even learned it as an undergraduate, frankly, that the myth that there were, in this period of time in Europe, especially in the 11th century, you had this huge population growth. That part is true. Actually, there was a big population growth in the 11th century. But the myth then would taught that because you had so many people, and you had second, third, and families had second, third, and fourth born sons, that and because of the rights of property and the you know, distribution of property and the whole rise of primogeniture, or the you know, the policy, if you will, that the oldest son or one son gets all the land in a family, that you had these second, third, and fourth born sons running around Europe without land, trying to get land, and so they were fighting each other. And it was causing all kinds of war and violence in European society. And so the church decided to take all these second, third, and fourth born sons and send them, you know, across the Mediterranean, mm-hmm. to the east to go fight Islam, to go fight Muslims and take their land. And that's one of the, you know, the major myths about the Crusades and why people are motivated. And like I said, it still continues to be a very popular understanding of the Crusades. But when you begin to look at the research of this and pull it back, pull the onion back, so to speak, you see that especially in the First Crusade, the ones who went on Crusade were not second, third, and fourth born sons, but rather first born sons who went. The ones who, in a certain sense, stood to lose the most by going on Crusade went. And why was that? Well, it's because families, especially French families, knew that what the Pope had asked them to do, to travel to the Holy Land, to liberate Jerusalem, especially the Holy Sepulchre, the Church of the Holy Sepulchre, from Islamic control, was such a unique opportunity, such a unique and important call, that the most important person in the family, the firstborn son, was the one that had to go. And that's mm-hmm. That's what happened. And not only that, they were motivated not by land and wealth, because it was a pilgrimage. What they saw they were doing was going on a pilgrimage. And just like you and I go on a pilgrimage to Rome or other shrines or places, Jerusalem even today, we go, we pray at the shrine, and we come home. And that's what they did. The vast majority of Crusaders who lived, especially on the First Crusade, went to Jerusalem. Those who remained or who lived through the event, most of them went home after they had liberated the holy city of Jerusalem. They didn't stay. Some did, but most of the vast majority who were still alive went home because it was a pilgrimage. And they went because of the spiritual privilege that they were granted by the Pope, the indulgence. And so there was a huge motivational or spiritual motivation behind why they did what they did that's usually not addressed in most modern understandings or tellings of the Crusades.
It's hard for us to understand, though. We don't live in that kind of an age, and so maybe we're cynical about it. Oh, they claim that they were concerned with their eternal salvation, but come on, there was money to be made. Do you see that? Like, we just don't think like they thought.
No, we don't, and that's the big you know, one of my favorite writers and historian, popular historians is Hilaire Belloc, right? The English he was a politician, author, historian, died in the mid 1950s. But he talks about that what you just described as kind of you know, reading backwards into history, right? The past or the modern day kind of seeing itself in a position of superiority to the past. That we know better than the people who lived before us, right? Oh, of course there was money that they were looking to get. You know, I mean, we tend to view past historical events through our own lens and through our worldview, and we apply that backwards. And that's reading backwards into history, and that's inappropriate. I mean, you know, the job of the historian really is to understand the period authentically from the perspective of those who lived in it, and then to present that to people in his or her own day and age. And so the best way to understand history is, again, to see it from that contemporary perspective. And that's, like, as you mentioned, that's why a lot of people struggle with understanding the Crusades, or why people would be motivated to do these things from a faith perspective, because that's not how we are motivated mostly, right, in the modern world.
No, we're right. That's not that's one that's unfamiliar to us, to live in a place where you know, even if you're a believer in the modern world, you're a believer amidst a prevalent kind of unbelief. Whereas if you were an unbeliever, I suppose, in the Middle Ages, you would have been an unbeliever amidst a prevalent atmosphere of belief. Everything pointed towards God and towards Christ.
Okay, I thought it was me for a second.
Are you still getting sound from me?
Oh, now I can hear you.
I don't know. I don't know what that's about. What do you want to do? Just pick up where I was? Okay. Steve, this is what I was attempting to get at, was the idea that it's hard for us. Because we, even a believer lives in a time, a believer today lives in a time of unbelief. And so that it's hard for us to imagine a time of belief where just everybody everywhere was believing in the things that that happened in the Bible. They believed in the promises of Christ. They believed in eternal life. These were real things for them. Well, we better take a break. We'll come back.
Okay.
Pick it up right there when we come back, because I can hear the music. We're talking about the Middle Ages with Steve Weidenkopf, the author of a brand new book on the Middle Ages. More of that right after this on Catholic Answers Live.
This is Dale Alquist of the American Chesterton Society, and you're listening to Catholic Answers Live.
In what forms does the Word of God come to us? How do we know that the Bible is inspired, inerrant, and complete? Why do we need tradition to help us understand Scripture? Doesn't the Bible teach that it alone is sufficient for salvation? In 20 Answers, Scripture and Tradition, you'll find smart, solid answers to these questions and many more, examining the first and most important issue in the Christian faith, the manner in which God has communicated to us the saving truths of the gospel. 20 Answers, Scripture and Tradition is part of the 20 Answers series from Catholic Answers, offering hard facts, powerful arguments, and clear explanations of the most important topics facing the Church and the world, all in a compact, easy-to-read package. Visit shop.catholic.com and take a look at this exciting new series from Catholic Answers Press.
If you spend any time on Twitter, Facebook, or mainstream media, you're probably familiar with the litany of slogans that skeptics employ to rescue you from the foolish belief that God exists. The constant onslaught seems to leave people with the idea that they have no alternative but to embrace atheism. How can a Christian respond? In One Less God Than You, John DeRosa breaks down 20 of the most common atheist challenges and shows you how to craft effective answers. Atheism is more aggressive and widespread than ever. Read One Less God Than You and prepare yourself to respond with the joyful truth that God is real. To get your copy of One Less God Than You, visit shop.catholic.com today or ask for it at a good Catholic bookstore near you.
Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live. I'm Cy Kelly, your host, and a very Merry Christmas to you and to all of yours. We're talking about the church in the Middle Ages because there's a brand new book out from Steve Weidenkopf called The Church and the Middle Ages, Cathedrals, Crusades, and wait, what's the third part of it? Cathedrals, Crusades, and the Papacy in Exile. That's it, the Papacy in Exile. Steve Weidenkopf is lecturer in church history at Christendom College Graduate School of Theology in Alexandria, Virginia, and the author of many other fun and engaging history books. I say that because I know that a lot of people think history books are not fun and engaging because the modern way of telling history it can be kind of dull. Not Steve. He tells stories and helps you understand and get into the mindset of the people of that time. That's what kind of where we left off before the break, and a little bit of a technical hiccup. But I want to go back to the question that I was asking you, Steve, which is that the even a believer today is at a disadvantage trying to understand the medieval person, because even a believer grows up in a world in which unbelief, or at least a kind of secular agnosticism, is the norm. And so we can't imagine, or I shouldn't say we can't, but it takes great effort for us to imagine and do justice to just how pervasive faith in Christ and his promises were in the Middle Ages.
Yeah, that's exactly true, Si. I mean, it's. I think you summed that up very well in terms of, you know, how we are living in a world that even believers, right, Catholics or others who have a deep faith life, you know, are living really in a sea of, you know, secular agnosticism or secular humanism, and it's difficult for us. And like you said, it takes great effort even for believers to kind of transport ourselves back into the minds of those and lives of those who lived before us, especially in the centuries in which I cover in this book, but I think that with that, right, that there's also a benefit to our belief from that perspective in terms of history. In that, what I mean by that is that I think a Catholic is unique, a modern day Catholic, even in a world where we struggle with the general, you know, sense of the world or the general disbelief of the world. We though have I think an easier time maybe, or a greater ability to understand the perspective of those who came before us, and answering some of these questions and looking at some of these historical events which modern day people struggle with, frankly. You know, we talked about the Crusades before the break briefly. I mean, that's exactly the point, is that, you know, we as believers can understand why a nobleman or, you know, a warrior of some sort, an archer or a spearman, might decide he wants to take the vow and go on crusade, principally because he can receive an indulgence, a plenary indulgence, because we know what those are. We know what that doctrine means. We know what benefit that provides for our souls. And so when we read that and we say, oh, that's why they went, yes, we can kind of get that more so than someone who's not. And I don't mean to say that historians or others who aren't of faith can't understand, you know, the spiritual motivation of those in this time period that we're talking about. You can, and many do, and there are many fantastic secular or non-Catholic, non-Christian historians of the Crusades that do get that. But there's a little more effort, a little more work involved in trying to figure that out. And still, I think it even presents a bit of a conundrum for people in that, you know, wow, I can maybe understand why they would do that, but that's something I could never do. And so you lose a little bit of association with those before us.
I'm just going to throw out another. I want you to settle this for me, whether this is a misconception. If I'm walking down the street in any medieval town or city, pretty much every day I'm going to run into them burning heretics. It's probably the stench of burning heretics. It just never goes away in the ancient world. And this was a terrible evil of medieval society, this persecution of free thinkers. What would you say to that? Am I pretty much – I think I'm getting it all right. Am I getting it all right?
Yeah, no, I would say you're getting it mostly wrong, frankly. Yeah.
All right, Steve Weidenkopf.
Yeah. No, but that is, I mean, what you say there is what many people think, right? Yeah, obviously, yeah. There's you know, all kinds of bonfires of witches, or, you know, trying to see if people float, and all these other kinds of things that is happening in the Middle Ages, and you know, that's just not true. I mean, you know, again, it you have to look at. We tend to see it, and because we talk about the term, we even use the Middle Ages, right, is a very kind of, you know, generic, amorphous term, you know, just like today, same was true in the medieval period, rather. There were regional differences, mm-hmm. you know, in throughout Christendom and throughout European society at the time. So, you know, whereas there might be, you know, the presence of medieval inquisitors, papally appointed inquisitors in the south of France, for example, during the 12th century, that you know, doesn't mean that was applicable everywhere throughout Christendom, right? So that's one false notion that we really have to disavow ourselves of is taking something that may have happened in one area or one regional, of Christendom and applying it across all of it. That's just not true, right? So, yeah, I mean, were there areas where there was heresy that was rampant, that was posing significant problems for the church and for secular authority? Absolutely. And that was dealt with. And one of the things I think that, we've talked about trying to understand the worldview of people who lived in a time that was so different from ours. Heresy is the exact point on which to really focus on that, because heresy for those living in the medieval period was not only just a spiritual matter, but it was also a secular concern as well, because secular rulers were concerned about the peace and security of those who lived in their realms and lived in their lands. And heresy, when you look at it and you study the history of heresy, heresy bred violence, right? It always produced a violent reaction in society, either from people attacking the heretics or heretics attacking, the people and believers. And so a secular lord was very concerned to ensure there was peace and stability in his land. And so there was a secular punishment for heresy, which was death, frankly. And then there was also a spiritual punishment for heresy, which was excommunication, and which was then maybe a visit by the papal inquisitors who would come and try to teach you the authentic faith and give you an opportunity to repent and to revert and to come back into the fold of the church. And the spiritual aspect also the church was concerned about, frankly, was, one's eternal soul, one's eternal status. Embracing heresy and the allowance of heresy to spread in a region placed, the populace, placed their souls in jeopardy. And that was a very real thing for people in the Middle Ages, and it is for believers today, as it should be for most people, frankly, today.
Well, that points to something. You said that peace and stability, that the secular ruler would be concerned about upsets to peace and stability. This, too, I think, is one of the ways in which we modern people really struggle to put ourselves in the mindset of a Christian person of the Middle Ages, in that they believed that all the important stuff happened after you died. If you please correct me if I'm wrong about what I'm about to say, but they didn't put the peace and stability would have been important to them in a way that it may not be to us, because we worry a lot about social progress and making progress so that the world becomes this, closer and closer to perfection each year. But for them, they wanted a peaceful and stable world in which people's salvation could be worked out, because all the important stuff was going to happen after you died.
Yeah, that's exactly right. I mean, I think you summed that up very well. It's so true, right? The worldview of people living in the Middle Ages was so rooted in the church and rooted in faith, as we've been talking about, that for them, what was important was your eternity, what happened afterwards. And obviously, they believed, as we believe today still, right, that what you do in this life has an impact on what happens in the next. But the next is what's important. And we live in an age, the postmodern age, if you will, where we are so focused, as you put it, on social progress, or we're so focused on temporal concerns that we have in many ways, frankly, lost the understanding of the importance of what happens after, of the last things, of what is the state of our soul and where we're going to live for eternity, if you will.
And so that affects how we think about the order of society, where we think, well, like this, like free expression, for example, we would basically allow the destruction of our society just so that, people could have free expression of things like pornography or violence or whatever, because we value this world more than the next world. We can't imagine a world that says, no, some things shouldn't be said, some things shouldn't be shown, and some beliefs should be said no to.
Yeah, exactly right. And that's why, people in the modern world struggle so much when we talk about this time period of heresy and of these, as I mentioned, papally appointed inquisitors. And it's after this period of time that to see the creation of what are known as the institutional tribunals, right? The actual inquisitions, like the Spanish Inquisition and those kinds of things. You know, that's that for us, we look at that. We look at Europe or in the church, you know, with this kind of process of investigating heresy and of you know, trying to ensure that people believed authentically in order that they can live authentically in eternity. You know, we just recoil at that, because we have no comprehension, right, we have very little appreciation for, you know, the fullness of truth and of objective truth and of an understanding that, yeah, again, how we act and how we believe impacts our eternity. Instead, we're focused on, as you point, you know, of ensuring that everyone has the freedom to say this or to say that or believe this or believe that. And that's completely anathema to people in the Middle Ages. They had no understanding of that, and it wasn't because and you know, just one point on that is it's not because they were ignorant, it's not because they were stupid, it's not because they were superstitious or zealots or things like that, as many people in the modern world think. You know, we tend to, again, have a negative view of this period of time, but rather it's because of what they valued, right, of how they understood life and how their society was organized and structured, and what they placed value in. They placed value in eternity, and that's something that we in the modern world tend to shortchange.
When we come back from the next break we have to take, I want to ask you about some of your favorite people, because you do cover a good number of people, and Francis and Dominic and Catherine of Siena and Thomas Aquinas and so many of other great people of the Middle Ages. Before we go to the break, however, I would like you to address one thing while we're talking about misconceptions. I don't know if this is a misconception or what it is. I mean, I would just like you to tell me something about the treatment of Jewish people in Christendom in this Middle Ages period, because I think a lot of people would just assume, well, it was just a horror show, the treatment of Jews in the Christian Middle Ages.
Yeah, exactly. That's not entirely true, right? It was a mixed bag, is the best way to put that, right? That there were times when sadly Jewish people were attacked for being Jewish. You know, and we see this, you know, after the calling of the First Crusade around the Rhineland area, there was one nobleman who went around with a band of followers attacking and killing Jewish people in cities all up and down the Rhine. Now, again, wasn't sponsored by the church. He wasn't told to do that by the church, is something he did on his own, but it you know, he generated a bunch of support, sadly, for it, and it occurred again even after that period and in the calling of the Second Crusade and what happened after that as well. Saint Bernard of Clairvaux, for example, had to personally go and rebuke a fellow Cistercian monk who was spewing anti-Semitic diatribes in the Rhineland, but he did. He put him down and shut him down and told him to go back to the monastery, which he did. But so there were periods and places within, you know, Europe and Christendom where there was anti-Semitic behavior, sadly, and pogroms that arise at times. But there were also periods and areas where Jews were accepted just as you know, obviously they were known and seen as being different. They were a minority in a majority Christian area and territories, and so there was a distinction there. You know, the merchant activity in which they engaged in different than Christians as well, so that separated them. So there's a lot of things that the society had that separated Jews and Muslims in Spain in particular from Christians. But in many ways, they were you know, left alone and were valued members of society, valued members of the town and the city. And for example, in Avignon in the south of France, when the popes lived there in the 13th century, the 14th century rather, you know, they protected the Jewish community in Avignon, made sure that they were you know, treated fairly. And when there was a myth or when there was a rumor that went around when you had the rise of the Black Death in the middle part of the 14th century that the Jews had started the Black Death, the Pope at the time issued a papal bull that, you know, disavowed that, said that's not true at all, and actually laid the penalty of excommunication on any Christian who abused a Jew because of that, right? Because of that belief or that thought. So the papacy even protected the Jewish people during that time as well. So you know, it's a mixed bag. I mean, but again, one of those things that you know, the individual actions or individual sinful actions of some Christians does not equate to the teaching of the church, right? And some people always conflate those two and confuse those two and think, oh, well, Jews were harassed at times in medieval Christian Europe. Therefore, the church was, you know, complicit in that. And that's just not true.
And there is, I mean, there's a kind of a basic testimony in that you can find very large, prosperous, flourishing Jewish communities far flung across all of Europe, even far into Northern Europe.
Yeah, that's very true. You know, and there were places, you know, in France, England, where the Jewish people were expelled by secular rulers. So, you know, there's, you know, there was a dispersion of them as well, sure. But then, you know, they are, you know, throughout the Middle Ages, frankly, by secular rulers, you know, expelled. And so then they find refuge in other areas, especially in Spain, frankly, up until at least the 15th century.
This is one of these areas where it's very helpful to have a historian who will tell you the story, warts and all, because it's clear from what you're saying there are warts in this regard that we can't look back and just go, oh, come on, the Jews had it great in the Middle Ages, but nuance is required here, and I appreciate that from you, Steve Weidenkopf. We always get that from you, and Steve's brand new book is called "The Church and the Middle Ages: Cathedrals, Crusades, and the Papacy in Exile." Let's take a look at some of the great figures of that period when we come back with Steve.
Hang on. Catholic Answers Live will return in a moment.
You've heard that St. Paul Street Evangelization supports hundreds of teams of evangelists sharing the good news. But did you know that some of these teams are public prayer stations? Set up a sign on the sidewalk and offer prayer and encouragement to those you encounter. Everyone needs prayer. Try this new method of witnessing to Jesus. Contact St. Paul Street Evangelization to get started at streetevangelization.com. That's streetevangelization.com.
Underwriting for Catholic Answers Live is provided by Real Estate for Life. Real Estate for Life connects home buyers and sellers to real estate agents while supporting pro-life organizations. On the web at realestateforlife.org.
EWTN, teaching the truth.
I love listening to Catholic radio. It's perfect. It provides peace and it builds us up and strengthens us. We listen to it whenever we're in the car. My husband and I love it. He got me started with it before he even became a Catholic. He owns his own business, and so he's working by himself, and he listens to Catholic radio, and he's called in several times too. It's using the technology that we have for good.
EWTN, live truth, live Catholic.
Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live. As the end of the year approaches, I'm sure there'll be weeping and wailing and gnashing of teeth as 2020 goes out. So many people regretting the passing of such a fine year. But we'll do our best. We'll muddle through. Maybe 2021 will provide a greater entertainment than 2020 did. A little bit of a rough year. I'm not giving out our number because we're just having a conversation with Steve Weidenkopf about his brand new book on the Middle Ages. Steve is a lecturer in history at the Christendom College Graduate School of Theology. And the new book, he's got a whole bunch of books, and you can find all of his books over at steveweidenkopf.com or at amazon.com or all over the internet. But the newest book came out on Christmas Day, or the release date was Christmas Day, The Church and the Middle Ages, Cathedrals, Crusades, and the Papacy in Exile. So we've talked a bit about, you know, in broad general terms about this period of the Middle Ages, but I think the way to end is on some of the personalities, because I have to say, you just say a few names from the 13th century, you know, Francis and Dominic and Thomas and Catherine, and you think this is possibly the greatest century in the history of the world. I mean, a century that can produce characters like that is a time of tremendous. Just to be able to do that, it says something wonderful about that era.
Oh, absolutely. I mean, it's you know, the historian Warren Carroll, who founded Christendom College, where I teach at, he termed this period of time that we're talking about the glory of Christendom, right? The glory of of this period. I mean, and that's true. I mean, that's really, there is such a gloriousness about it. Yeah. Although we've talked about it, there's, you know, warts in it as well. So it's not like everything was perfect and everybody was a walking saint. But, you know, it was a period of just intense, you know, powerful activity, you know, in the realm of faith, in the realm of, you know, military and politics, lots of things going on here, lots of great personages, as you mentioned, Francis, Dominic, Thomas, you know, Albert, others. But even before them, there were some great people, and I cover them in my book in this little section that we call Up Close and Personal, where we talk about, I highlight a few different figures of the of this period of time that I'm talking about in my book. And one of them is Abbot Suger of Saint-Denis. And for anybody who's been to Paris and been north of Paris and to the Church of Saint, the Abbey Church of Saint Denis, there, it's a beautiful church that is the traditional burial place of the kings of France. And so you can walk through the church, and still today, and see, you know, the tombs of so many different French kings, and just, you know, all these important people of history, you know, that are buried there. It's quite fantastic place. And Suger was responsible for building that. Right, he was the one who really is credited with starting the kind of, you know, the beginnings of the Gothic architectural style, right? That the vaulted ceilings, the high mirrors, the rose windows, the you know, the ultimately would be the flying buttresses and things outside to support the high walls with the windows. And just, he's, you know, we talked about earlier about someone being able to rise through the ranks, if you will, of the church, regardless of where you came from. Suger was the son of a serf. He came from very poor background. But he rose to become an abbot. He rose to become regent, frankly, of the Kingdom of France. When King Louis VII went on the Second Crusade in the middle part of the 12th century, he appointed Suger to be regent. So he acted, in essence, as king while the king was gone for a number of years on the crusade. This is the son of a serf, right? Amazing how he was able to do that. But a man of great faith, of great intelligence, and one who, you know, had a great – his faith moved him to beauty and the expression of beauty in this architectural style with this church. So if any listener has an opportunity to go into Paris, north of Paris, especially hopefully in 2021 when things are hopefully back to normal, we can travel a bit better, definitely you have to see the Abbey Church of Saint-Denis. It's beautiful.
This is another great thing, is that right into the modern era, many of the institutions and the buildings, the institutions, they still survive. It's amazing to think of, you know, in this period that you write about, I believe that's the beginning of the English Parliament and the beginning of the University of Paris, and now called the Sorbonne, I think. But there are institutions in the modern world that trace their time back to here, back to these years.
Absolutely. Yeah, that's there's a great quote I have in the book from G.K. Chesterton. He makes that point, right, that so often, even in his time, right, that so often earlier in the 20th century, so often people thought of the Middle Ages or medieval as something brutish and nasty and bloody, as we've talked about. But then he notes, he says, people forget that, you know, parliaments are medieval, that universities are medieval, that many of the things that we you know, like about the modern world, or that we find, you know, good about the modern world, were created during this period of time, you know, and we're standing on the shoulders of those who've come before us, you know, who created those things for us. So it's beautiful. Yeah.
Any other figures you want to, I mean, persons, people who lived in that period that you want to commend to us?
Oh yeah, I really love Godfrey de Bouillon too. I mean, I tried to highlight in the book not just saints. So we talked about Suger, not a saint, but a churchman. I also try to bring up, you know, lay people who were not saints, and Godfrey de Bouillon is one of them. And Godfrey was one of the major crusade leaders on the First Crusade. He was from what is now, you know, German territory, Alsace, Lorraine, French territory too. And he was just a warrior that was imbued with a love of God and a love of the church, and went on crusade and participated in that armed pilgrimage because of that. You know, he cared for his men. He led by example. He was in the thick of all the fighting and the battle. He wasn't we would call it a rear guard commander, right, of military forces. He led from the front. You know, one of the beautiful things I like about Godfrey is at the end of the First Crusade, which was successful, they liberated the Holy City of Jerusalem. you know, they wanted to they had to protect the territory that they had liberated. So they decided to create a kingdom, the Kingdom of Jerusalem, a feudal territory, and they were going to appoint a king. And one of the other crusade leaders who went, Count Raymond of Toulouse, he really wanted to be king, but he didn't want to be seen as wanting to be king. If you get the drift, right? So I want to be king, but sure. I don't want to look like I'm you know. Politicking for it, if you will. Right. So the other leaders asked him and said, "You want to be king?" to Count Raymond. And he said, no, I really don't," hoping that they would say, "Oh, please. But when he said no, they said, "Okay." And then they went to somebody else. They went to Godfrey and said, "Do you want to be king?" And he said, "No, I'm not. I won't be king, but I will, you know, be the feudal protector, if you will, of the city of Jerusalem." And so he took the title Defender of the Holy Sepulchre, right? Defender of the Church of Jerusalem, yeah. Which was the point. And, you know, small T tradition holds that he said, you know, apocryphal story, but it's apt in keeping with his character. Godfrey said, I refuse to take a crown of gold in the city where my Savior wore a crown of thorns. And that really exhibits, right? And again, that's probably apocryphal. He may not have ever said it, but it really bespeaks of who he really was and the mindset that he had and how he approached life, which is emblematic of people in the Middle Ages anyways.
Wonderful. I love the choices. Thank you very much for sharing them. I know you have many, many more, and they're in the book. So I'm just recommend to people again, before you forget, get this book. You're just going to be so happy that you did. And knowing medieval history, even a little bit, gives you a greater a grounding in the real world. Just go to you can go wherever good Catholic books are sold and get The Church and the Middle Ages, Cathedrals, Crusades, and the Papacy in Exile. Steve Weidenkopf is the author. Steve, thanks. I really appreciate you taking the hour to help us remember such an important time.
My pleasure, Zai. Thanks again so much. Merry Christmas and Happy New Year to you.
Merry Christmas and Happy New Year. And we'll hope for a good one in 2021 when we can all go and visit Saint-Denis in just outside of Paris. We're right back after this with more Catholic Answers Live. Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live. I'm Cy Keller, your host. A very merry Wednesday of the Christmas octave. So it's Merry Christmas during, and it's still Christmas for us Catholics. We on the big feast, we don't give up. We go for 8 days, 8 straight days of Christmas, and we come out of the Crusades and into building a healthy marriage. We have our good friend Rose Sweet here with us. First of all, Merry Christmas, Rose.
Same to you, Cy. I hope it's a lovely season for you and for Missy.
Well, thanks. Thanks very much. I'll tell her you said that. She's going to have me home. So, I mean, what a gift. What a Christmas gift.
No comment.
yeah, because we do these, we pre-record these during Christmas week. And I probably am at home right now. Probably home listening to myself on the radio thinking,
wow. This is too confusing. I don't know. Let's just pretend we're live.
So Rose, before we get started though, I mean, people know you from rosesweet.com. They know you from all the work that you have done on helping Catholics when marriage is in difficulty with divorce and annulment and other difficulties in marriage. People know you from, you did a great video series on divorce that was used practically in every parish in America, I think, or has been used in practically every parish in America. And now you're doing a series of four books that are women's guides that are like little treats. They're beautiful books. I love this. They're physically beautiful books and they have a lot of beautiful stuff in them. So first of all, tell us about the women's guides that you're working on.
Well, thank you, Cy. They are pretty. They can fit in your purse, and they're hardcover, and they're really good for gift-giving, especially this season. So most of my signature talks, I help people put our religion into the relationships. And so over the years, my talks that are about how we do that, drawing on the principles of our Catholic faith, have evolved into these four little books. And number 3 is out. I have it right here, A Catholic Woman's Guide to relationships, and that's number three in the series of four. And I'm supposed to be writing the fourth one right now, but I'm a little behind. Because
A Woman's Guide to Procrastination will be the next book.
Yes, exactly, exactly. No, actually, it's going to be on temperaments. So the first one was on happiness.
Yeah.
Basically, if we don't get how we understand happiness and our desire for it, which is a good desire, if we don't get that right, we're probably going to get everything else wrong. So I started with happiness, and then the second one is on romance, and it's not just for singles.
Yeah.
There's a greater cosmic call into this divine romance for all of us. So that's number two. And number three is relationships, and number four is temperaments. I can't wait to do that one. It's fun.
Does that include phlegmatic and what are those? Those classical temperaments?
That's it.
You know, Rose, it seems to me that your work is so important in this regard, in that mostly we're lied to about what makes us what could possibly make us happy now. And I think it leads just to tremendous heartbreak. As a matter of fact, people have to often go through decades of heartbreak before they learn the most basic things about life, like I want someone to love me, you know, and that it's okay to want to be with one person for your whole life.
Well, that was me. I did it all the wrong way. I'm a cradle Catholic, and I always loved Jesus and Mary, and I never really threw them away, but I was really pursuing everything else, happiness on my own terms. And this is what I love about Catholic Answers. When I dug myself into a deep enough pit and I was miserable and I wanted true happiness and I called out to God, it was the gems and the truth of the Catholic faith that got me grounded and back where I needed to be.
Yeah.
You know, the apologetics are absolutely necessary because, well, especially what you guys do, that's filling the mind and correcting the way we think. So apologetics is actually necessary to then help you move into healthy relationships and to love as Jesus loved us.
Yeah, that's right. Getting the mind around some basic truths can change everything. And
right.
It's amazing how much of our media society is geared towards keeping us from getting our mind around those basic truths and focused on all kinds of things that will do nothing but rob us of our happiness.
Yeah, but we believe the lies because they sound good and they tickle our ears.
Right, that's right. Okay, so Rose, we want to draw on your latest book, A Woman's Guide to Relationships, and we'll talk about the relationship of marriage this hour. So probably the one thing that is most natural to us is to want to have a happy marriage. I mean, marriage is a sacrament because Christ elevated a natural thing to a sacrament. It's the only one where he took something that already exists, that everybody wants, it's already clear everybody wants it, and he raised it up to the level of the sacrament. This is basic to us. Marriage is basic to us. Even if we're not married, it's basic to the structure of our being.
Right. And what we tend to think, because we don't stop and examine what we're thinking and our thoughts, we tend to think that a happy marriage is from the other person being and doing everything that we want.
Oh, yeah.
You know, I promised my husband I wasn't going to talk about the sandwich on this show. But
it's me who usually brings up the sandwich. And so
I
apologize to him.
So we're talking about building a healthy marriage. And, you know, my husband is like, really? You know, so yes, honey. Yes, yes, yes. But it's true. We do desire it because it's a foreshadowing of really of that intimate, reliable, secure relationship that we have with God. And we begin to learn that what awaits us, that is God's promise to us when we begin to experience some of that love in our own families, first from our mom and dad, then our siblings, and then ultimately in marriage. So it's important stuff. So
all right, so give us some of your wisdom about relationships. You mentioned to me that your dad was in construction, and you have learned a vital lesson about relationships from your dad.
Yeah, well, you know, we're going to title this show Building a healthy marriage. Yeah. And I love the analogy of building. I went to scripture in preparation for this show, and I really saw two things I hope we can cover in this hour. That God talks a lot in the Old Testament and the New about building one's house, building a home. And, you know, we have to build it on a solid foundation. But then recently, especially with the Jewish holiday of Hanukkah, in the Old Testament, we read about when the bad guys, the Greeks, were coming to take over the Jews' temple and make them be, you know, worship the Greek gods, and they defiled the temple. And we are temples of the Holy Spirit. And how Judas Maccabeus went and kicked the bad guys out and then had to purify the temple. And I want to talk about what he did to get that temple back in order. And really, a marriage is two people who are two temples of the Holy Spirit. And right. Those temples are defiled. It's going to be really hard building a good house, a good, healthy, holy, happy house. So that's where I want to dive in today. So yes, my dad, in the 1950s and 60s, he was one of the leading developers of residential properties in Northern California. So on Sundays after Mass, and he would cook a big breakfast for everybody, then he'd load us all in the station wagon, because there was tons of us, and we would drive out to his projects or to competing projects, and we'd go through the model homes. Oh. I loved it. I swear I was born with the Pottery Barn gene, because I loved going, you know, from our house with nine kids running around, and into these beautiful homes where everything was perfect and everything was decorated. And I was like, oh, this is beautiful. And I was really drawn to that, the beauty of the interior of a home. But it was in later years, as Dad took me on his construction sites and would show me how they laid a foundation and put in steel rebar and built the walls. And I could see the house being built from the outside, which is really more important. The decorating, that should come last. And I think a lot of us in our marriages, we're trying to decorate our marriage and the foundation is crumbling.
Right. So, yes. That's a great metaphor. Right, Rose.
It is. So here's another story about my dad. When he was a young teenager, his dad, they lived in Northern California in a farming area, and they purchased an old wooden bridge that was going to be replaced with a concrete bridge. And the two of them, with a mules and buckboards or whatever, they took all those timbers from the bridge. They disassembled it, took it home. And then my dad said, my grandpa had this huge circular saw, zzz, and they would run those beams through the saw to make timber.
Yeah.
And then they ended up building from that bridge four little homes to house some of the farm workers in that area in Northern California. So my dad got to see, he worked with his dad laying the foundation, taking those timbers, wiring, plumbing, everything.
Right.
And that's what made my dad really good at what he did, because he knew how to do it from the ground up. I never knew or really stopped to even think about what building a marriage and a good household is from the ground up. I was just trying to decorate it.
Right.
You know?
Yes, right. Well, Rose, all throughout Scripture, actually, God uses the analogy of building a house to talk about our life and our marriages. So we have to take a quick break. When we come back, we'll dig into you've tapped into the divine, the analogy here, building a house. And so we'll exploit what Scripture has to say about that when we come back. Rose Sweet is our guest. We're talking about building a healthy marriage on this Wednesday Christmas episode of Catholic Answers Live. Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live, and Merry Christmas to you as we are in the octave of Christmas. still celebrating the birth of the Lord. At least 8 days. You got to take at least 8 days to celebrate the birth of the Lord. Hope it's a happy, joyful time in your home. No, I know it's been a difficult year. There's probably been stress on virtually every marriage in the world this year, connected to all the difficulties of the year. As we approach the end of the year, we thought we'll talk about, let's talk about the basics of marriage, building a healthy marriage. And this, if you're going to talk about building a healthy marriage, you call Rose Sweet and you go, Rose, we could do an hour with this. And she said, yes. So you start in your notes I have here, Rose, you talk about God using building as an analogy. And you start with my personal favorite quote from scripture. I don't know how it became, but this one just sticks in my head all the time, from Psalm 127. Mm-hmm. You want me to read it, or you want to?
Yeah.
All right.
No, you read it.
It's just one little line, and this is mm-hmm. the whole story of human life. Unless the Lord builds the house, those who build it labor in vain.
Okay, we could unpack that for a long, long time. And here's the beautiful thing. It's not just the house. It's not just the marriage. It's everything that surrounds it. It's everything that goes into it, everything that affects it. It's all the people in the relationship, Well, in the marriage, there should be only one person, but in scripture, the house was your whole household, everybody. And we have to have the right foundation for how we see each other in marriage and family. And Here's the other thing that I love that the Catholic Church teaches. Even two atheists who don't even believe that God needs to build the house, unless the Lord builds a house, if they tap into what God naturally gave them, the morals and the desire for what's good and true and beautiful and kind and loving with each other,
right?
God will even bless that marriage and those people, not with the same supernatural extra graces that come with the sacrament, but even those people can build a house that is under the Lord, and they don't know it or believe it, but it is. That makes sense.
It does make sense, actually. It's quite, I mean, part of allowing the Lord to build the house is doing it his way, and people have a natural intuition. I'm supposed to be kind to my spouse, and if we are not kind to our spouse for whatever reasons, often I think, Rose, it comes from a sense of hurt and justification on my part. Like, I have a reason not to be kind, you know? But still, that's not how the Lord builds the house, no matter what our justification is.
And that's why we need to go to scripture and need have good apologetics, which is what Catholic Answers does. Dive deep into the scripture, into the teachings of the church and the traditions to help us understand so that we can lay a solid foundation. That's how God builds it. And I love what St. Paul says. If you want to be transformed, you do it by the renewing of your, and when I pause, some people go, heart? You know, desires? No. The renewing of our mind. How we think. What we think about what's true and good and beautiful and right. So that's why it's so necessary that we get it right. That we build our house on what we know and what the church has proposed for us for our belief for so long.
All right, give me some more scripture. Lay some more scripture on me about building the house.
Well, I love this one. And this is kind of for people who are discerning marriage too. For which of you desiring to build a tower or a marriage does not first sit down and count the cost, whether he has enough to complete it? That's from Luke 14, chapter 28. So whether you're planning on getting married and building a healthy marriage or you're in one right now, there's a cost to you. If you want the desired effect, what are you going to have to pay? What are you going to have to do to get the kind of marriage that you want? And that requires sitting down and planning. You know, have you and Missy ever built a house from the ground up, or bought a house, right?
We did. We've done both. Yeah.
But before you did that, you had to sit down at the table and go, okay, what do we want?
Yeah.
How big? Where is it? What kind of rooms? There's a lot of thinking and planning before you even pick up the phone and call your realtor or your contractor.
And then you learn this basic lesson: double right. whatever you came up with financially and triple the amount of time it's going to take. And then you're because
okay. No. And I love that you said that because let's take that and put that. That's the same thing in relationships. It's going to be a lot harder and maybe take a longer time than you realize. And that's where we need the virtue of patience. And, you know, we can go back to scripture again, all the virtues on patience. There's a million of them. But I'm not patient enough to read all of them. So,
you are, Rose. Yep. This is, I think, where we maybe the romantic side of it makes us fall short. And you've written the book on romance, but I shouldn't have to talk this all through. Or it's not romantic to get down into the nitty gritty of of money and time and numbers and all that. That's so unromantic. So we resist it when we're young, especially, I think.
Well, young or immature, because that's how kids think. I don't want to do the hard work. I don't want to save my allowance to go to Disneyland. Can't you just pay for it, or whatever it is. It's a self-centered and immature way of looking at oneself in the world and what's required to get where we want to go. So I always said, how come nobody told me marriage was going to be so hard? Well, even if they did, would I have listened? We don't listen. We're stuck on, oh, that looks good. I want to marry that person. I want to do this. And even if you're in marriage, I want to buy a new house. I want to do this. And maybe your husband or your wife is like going, we don't have enough money.
Yeah. Well, let me ask you this, because there must be some encouragement in scripture too, for the fact that if you lay the foundation well, you're going to be okay. And I say this because on the one hand, we have this very romantic view of marriage. On the other hand, young adults are not getting married. They're delaying marriage far too long to be good for them. You and I know this. Mm-hmm. Me from experience, you're so young, you may not know this from experience, but you become less malleable as you age. You know, you're not doing yourself a favor by waiting till 35 rather than 25, unless you need that time to mature. But I mean, there's a reason why for most of history, people got married. They didn't wait around till they had finished every single video game, and now I'm ready to get married. So I want you to give me some encouragement too from scripture that if I do lay that foundation, that I can make it. It's going to be okay. Marriage actually works. God didn't make an institution that doesn't work.
Well, it's not only that it just doesn't work, but when the bad things of life come, and they will come, I mean, look at this year, that we will withstand the storm. And that's one, and we're going off in a big tangent here, but, that's one problem with the younger people who are delaying marriage. As parents, for too long, we've made it very easy for them and protected them from struggle, so that when things hit, bad things in life hit, outside of marriage or in a marriage, they bail, they don't want to do it, they run, they cry, they need a safe space.
I see, yeah, yeah.
Yeah, so... marriage, building a healthy marriage really starts when they're about 2 years old. Train them in the way of not being selfish, of cooperating with their brothers and sisters, of pitching in on the household chores, of being respectful and obedient. When dad or mom lays down a law and they don't like it, they are obedient to it. We need that to build a healthy marriage. We need obedience. We need respect. We need patience. We need, delayed gratification. So we need virtue and character. Those are the cornerstones of how to build a healthy marriage. And if we haven't promoted virtue in our kids, we're lost. Well, we're not totally lost, because we always have our Lord. And he never lets go of us, but he lets us dig our own holes.
Yeah, well, I think you and I both, I mean, you've just described it in your own life. We're both evidence that you can do a lot of bad building and God will fix it. I mean, if you let him. I mean, once you turn it over to him, he's got his ways of making it all right.
Well, and here's a beautiful, this is from Isaiah 58, verse 12. And your ancient ruins shall be rebuilt, So even though you made a big mess of your life, I made a big mess, our Lord loves us so much and he's so faithful. When we're finally ready, he will move in with the bulldozers, if that's what it takes, and rebuild. You shall raise up the foundations of many generations. That means when we get our marriages right, it's going to affect our children and their children's children. You shall be called the repairer of the breach and the restorer of streets to dwell in. So there are lots of promises in Scripture that if it's never that, too late
for that restoration. Yeah.
Right.
And so let me, if I may, there's another analogy in the Scripture of Christ to the church for marriage. And the key thing with Christ, right, you know, the when he speaks to the apostles at the apex of where he's preparing to make his sacrifice for all of us, he says, "I no longer call you servants, but friends." And so we do have, I feel like Christianity is, people don't remember this, but Christianity is the religion that introduced the idea of friendship, marriage as friendship. Before that, I mean, where in the world did you find marriage as friendship? It was a contract and all these, and many, many good things, but it's been elevated in the Christian view. So how, in your mind, how important is friendship to this building of the marriage?
Well, it's absolutely important because true friends never bring harm to another and never use one another. Those are the things that we do in marriage. We love each other. We tend to use each other. When the romance goes, you want to have a friend there next to you. If you're not, you're not still not hot, baby. You know, what happened to you? Gained 10 pounds and you're wrinkled. It's like, well, that doesn't matter if you're friends, if you love that person and you've built a solid friendship.
10 pounds would have been good for me. If I could have kept it at 10 pounds, that'd have been perfect. Take a quick break. More on building a healthy marriage, a happy marriage, a joyful marriage with Rose Sweet, the expert in these things, right after this on Catholic Answers Live.
Stay with us for more Catholic Answers Live.
Why is it wrong to help someone commit suicide? Don't people have a right to die with dignity rather than being a burden to others? Does the Church teach that the terminally ill must be kept alive by machines for as long as possible? In 20 Answers End-of-Life Issues, you'll find smart, solid answers to these questions and many more, helping you unravel the controversies and confusions surrounding euthanasia, assisted suicide, and the rights of patients in our uncertain healthcare future. 20 Answers End of Life Issues is part of the 20 Answers series from Catholic Answers, offering hard facts, powerful arguments, and clear explanations of the most important topics facing the Church and the world, all in a compact, easy-to-read package. Visit shop.catholic.com and take a look at this exciting new series from Catholic Answers Press.
To many people, even many Christians, purgatory is a fantasy. Or worse, a wicked lie invented by the Church to make salvation complicated and keep people in fear. But I'm here to tell you that purgatory is fact, not fiction. The Bible supports it, Christians have historically believed in it, and it makes theological sense. In my new book, Purgatory is for Real, I provide the evidence and reasoning to help you understand this controversial doctrine and demonstrate how it's actually a joyful, hopeful reality, not something shadowy and mysterious, but a sign of God's love and mercy. To get your copy of Purgatory is for Real, visit shop.catholic.com today or ask for it at a good Catholic bookstore near you.
Did you know you can access Catholic Answers Live right from your phone or other mobile device? Download the Catholic Answers Live app today. The Catholic Answers Live app, available now on iOS and Android.
Welcome back. Merry Christmas. Thanks for being with us. I'm Cy Kellett, your host. This is Catholic Answers Live, and our Christmas present, one of our Christmas presents to you this year, is an hour with Rose Sweet talking about building a healthy marriage. More than anything, I always hope, and this is because I have young adults, that there's young people who haven't married yet listening when we do a show like this, because I always wish my kids would listen to a show like this. They don't listen to me. That seems to be a habit they've developed. Actually, they do. They pretend like they don't, you know, but they're good people, and I don't want to paint a bad picture of them, like they don't listen to their dad, sometimes as a parent, you would like someone else to reinforce some of these things. Like you'd like them not to be watching Netflix where it's all undermined all the time. If you are a young person listening, I hope that it will be helpful to you, because it is my strong belief that virtually everything the world is telling you about marriage is wrong and a lie and unhelpful to you. And Rose is a person of great experience and wisdom. And the church is an institution of great experience and wisdom that can offer you a great deal of help. So Rose, we've been talking, you've been using the metaphor of building. And it's all there in scripture about building. Building as the thing that we do, in a certain sense. I mean, it's so fascinating that God himself came to us as a carpenter. It's clear what the signal is. All throughout the scripture, there's good builders and bad builders. I mean, St. Peter, when he's addressing the Sanhedrin, you builders, and he means it in an evil way, like you builders, meaning you're trying to build a world without God. And God's whole thing is, I'll build it with you, just let me into the process. And that's true with our marriages as well.
Right, and made in God's image, as we share in his creative, God is the builder. He created a creation.
Yeah.
And so we share in that with him, made in his image. We are creators and builders. And he wants us to focus those energies and those talents the right way. I need to say something right away when you go, Roll Sweet is an expert. And it's like, okay, hang on. All I do is draw on the riches and beauty and wisdom of the Catholic Church. It's not mine. And ask my husband, someday you're going to have, we'll have Missy and Bob here on the show with us. And I fail as a wife many, many times.
So does
but
Missy.
I keep going. Oh my God. Missy. Call me.
Sorry. What I was supposed to say is I fail as a husband much. I went the wrong way on that one. Sorry, I went left when I should have gone right. I fail too as a husband. Yes, go ahead, Rose. Sorry.
You're pretty hilarious. So, but we have, that's the hope we have in Christ and in the graces from the sacraments to get back up in the saddle and ride off into the sunset in the direction that we want to go. So, yes. Here's the other thing. I'm an addict of HGTV. not really an addict, but I love all those shows that are about building and tearing down and, you know, exposing the rot and fixing it and then having, you know, they're makeovers. They're like beauty makeovers for houses.
Right.
Well, we can do the same thing for our marriages. And one of the things that I noticed from watching those shows, I have like a little 4-point blueprint that I use to help people take a look at their marriages that are like struggling. And I'm saying, you don't need divorce. You just need to do a little rebuilding here.
Yeah.
And so here they are. It's get in touch with your desires. Let's say you're having a marriage that's kind of blah or in worse trouble. Sit down together and say, what do we want? What are our deepest desires? Because how are you going to get there unless you know what you want? So you make a list of the things that you deeply desire, both of you. Get in touch with your dreams. You know, where do we want to be in the future? What do we want to get rid of? Then I have what we call demo day. If you ever watch those shows, they always come in after they've planned and they've inspected and said, well, this doesn't work. They come in and they tear it down.
Yeah.
There's things in your marriage and my marriage too that appear that need to be torn down. There are things that we have to constantly pull things apart and go, uh-oh, and we have to get rid of that and clean it out and tear it down. Demo day is something I think every marriage should do at least once a year. You know, get in touch with the dreams, but then you have to go, what's in the way of the dreams?
Right.
And the last thing is detachment. A lot of times when you're building a home, you might bring too much stuff into it. You have too much furniture, too many sets of towels and dishes, too much activity. So here we are in our lives. We have too many things on our plate, too many games we have to go to, too many video games we're playing, too much shopping, too much eating, too much drinking, too much visiting. Our lives are overstuffed. So I'll never forget the show on HGTV where they went into these people's house and took everything out and put it in the front yard and on the driveway.
Yeah.
Everything.
Yeah.
Emptied the house and said, okay, now we're only bringing back in what we need and what works and what is beautiful. And so working with what they already had, they didn't have to have any big new thing. It's just rearranging what's really good and important and getting rid of, having a yard sale, going to confession, get rid of the stuff that doesn't work.
So that's like the HGTV and model. It's but it also draws on exactly what the Catholic Church has taught, what God has given us in His revelation about marriage. It's hard, I think, when there is a lot of hurt, because these things build up. You know, you most of us, I think, Rose, we'll go down the wrong road for a long way before we go, oh man, come on, I'm on the wrong road. I need to back all the way back up to where the road forked and redo this. So it's hard to share your desires with someone who has become, in our mind, we can build the other person up as the enemy of our desires. You're the one, right. Basically, you're the problem. You're the one that gets in the way of me having the life that I want.
Right. And that's why, thank God, we have the sacrament of confession. That is a regular, and that's why the church says, you should be going to confession on a regular basis, not this once a year thing. It's like, get in there on a regular basis and take an inventory of what has accumulated in your house,
yeah,
in your temple,
right?
And get rid of it. The other thing that I love is the litany of humility. I mean, I love it and I hate it.
Yeah.
Because it's a constant reminder of how I keep slipping into the me, part that really takes down marriage and every relationship, or even friendships. Selfishness is the worst. It's like termites.
Yeah.
It invades and eats away from the inside out.
So of your four here, you work on your desires and dreams together, have demo day where you get, and then detach from things. It seems to me that the first two, desires and dreams, have to do with reattaching to one another, and then the second two have to do with detaching from everything that's getting in the way of that. How did I do?
You're brilliant. You're brilliant. See?
Thanks.
Missy, you do need to call me.
Yeah.
No. No, and that's what it is. This is a simple rhythm. It's almost like a heartbeat, you know? Go back to the good, get rid of the bad. Go back to the good, get rid of the bad. Everything in creation is there to lead us to the ultimate happiness that we want in marriage or not in marriage. And we have the church to guide us.
Can I tell you something? This is exactly like what I see when I see you talking about this is exactly the pattern of the Christian life for every single person, which is attached to the right thing, detached from the wrong things. This is what Jesus, I mean, he starts his preaching with repent and believe the good news. He says things like, I'm the vine, you're the branches. He says things like, if your hand causes you to sin, cut it off. Now, obviously your hand doesn't cause you to sin, so don't, it's a metaphor, but
right.
So please, nobody cut your hand off. But it all has to do with attaching properly and detaching from the things that are wrecking that.
St. John of the Cross, a wonderful Spanish mystic and poet. I'm sure many of the listeners know of St. John's beautiful works. But he says the whole spiritual life can be contained in this one thought: away from things and toward God. Not that things are bad. People and things and all the things in creation and all the blessings that we have, they are good, but none of them is as good as God.
Yeah.
So away from the bad toward the good on a regular basis, on a regular basis.
And if we're honest about our desires, often we're doing things for the other person that is really not for them. It has to do with our, you know, like the husband who's working and working and working all the time to provide a certain, you know, something, and and the wife who's waiting is thinking, I don't want any of that. I would like, you know, him, you know, and women do the same thing where we're, this is why it strikes me that your HGTV model is so healthy, because if I don't know your desires and dreams, I'm working on fulfilling a person who doesn't exist.
I love looking back at my mom and dad's marriage. They had a really good balance with that. With the 9 kids, my dad was always working, right? And mom would have put the dinner and down and be irritated because he didn't show up on time. But at the same time, she talked to us and she made it very clear, sometimes your dad can't come home. Sometimes I don't get to sit down and have a nice dinner alone with your dad because he is working to support us.
Yeah.
So my mom really modeled, dad and mom both, we got to go do these things, but we will come back together. And one of the things that I love most of all when I look back is they were so dedicated to us kids and taking care of everything. But every 6 weeks or so, they got a babysitter and left every darn one of us for 3 days and went to San Francisco for a romantic weekend. They didn't, you know, how many parents a day even think about leaving their children to just go away for themselves and rekindle their relationship, their friendship?
Right.
And we loved when they were gone because it's always fun with the babysitter. But also when mom and dad came back, they were really happy.
Yeah.
And things were really beautiful around our home. So it's that constant tension of, you know, moving there but not going too far and then coming back to what's important. It's a dance.
Rose, the two kind of images you gave us about building a healthy and happy marriage involved the building and then the purification of the temple. You had another metaphor, and I haven't spent enough time on that. So we're going to take a quick break and we're going to come back with, because a lot of us, I mean, I don't know, I want to say in the modern world, but I suppose it's just the world. The modern world isn't very innovative in this regard. We do need to purify the temple. We do need help in that regard so that we are presented to our spouse in a way that is worthy of our spouse. So we'll take a quick break, okay, Rose, and we'll come back and do that.
Sounds good.
All right, right back with more Catholic Answers Live.
Catholic Answers Live, we're here for you.
Underwriting for Catholic Answers Live is provided by Real Estate for Life. Real Estate for Life connects homebuyers and sellers to real estate agents while supporting pro-life organizations. On the web at realestateforlife.org.
Do you love sharing the gospel and want to learn to be more effective? Join the St. Paul Street Evangelization Online School of Evangelization. You will learn to build bridges of trust and make disciples by befriending strangers, proclaiming the gospel, inviting people to the church, and praying with others. We'll ask for a pledge of financial support, but if you are unable to give, we'll give you a membership at no cost. Find out more and get involved today at streetevangelization.com. That's streetevangelization.com.
Now, not only can you watch EWTN anywhere, but anytime with EWTN On Demand. Get on-demand access to more than 12,000 EWTN programs, including live shows and specials, all in one place, all free. Just go to EWTN.com/on-demand. There's nothing to fill out, no memberships required, and no fees to pay. All you need is an internet connection, and you're good to go. EWTN On Demand. Fast, easy, and free.
Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live, and a very Merry Christmas to you. I just love to say it. I want to keep saying it. Christmas goes on and on. It's not just a day. It's a season, and we're happy to get to share some of that season here with you on Wednesday afternoon. Talking about marriage, as we come towards the end of the year, I don't know. It's fun. It's a funny thing. It's just it's all, you know, the end of the year, the beginning of the year, it's not a natural phenomenon or something like that. It's something that we create with the calendar. But still, as the year comes to an end, we want to get to the basic things. And as the new year begins, we want to be working on the basic things. I don't know. It's something to do with our psyche, how we go around the calendar like it's a cycle like that. But we do want to talk about basic things. And probably if you could save one institution In order to save our society from the obvious path of destruction that it's on, you would save marriage. And the only way to do that is to work on your own marriage. That's really the one way we've been given to do that. So our good friend Rose Sweet is here with us. We've talked a lot so far about building marriage, particularly about building with the Lord as part of that building process of building a healthy, happy, whole marriage. Now we want to talk a little bit about purification, because this is part of the process as well. The Lord doesn't just build the temple. He's got to clean it every now and then.
Yeah, my spiritual director gave me this reading recently, and it really hit me. I'm always looking for those 3 points or 4 steps of this or whatever, as you can tell, because that cements it in my mind, and I can go back to it on a quick basis. But it was about 160 years BC. I think Judas Maccabeus, the Greeks were coming over and trying to force them away from their Jewish religion and make them, you know, make them worship the Greek gods. And they took the temple over, and they defiled the temple. They did bad things in the temple, and they forced the Jewish people to do bad things in the temple. And when Judas Maccabeus and his tribes, you know, got the temple back, the first thing they had to do was purify it. And they did 5 things. And I thought, this is absolutely beautiful for us just as individuals to do with our lives and then in our marriages. So the first one that they did was they tore down the altars that were built to the false gods. We have altars that we erect to false gods in our heart and in our marriages. In my own heart, the biggest altar at all of all is to the God me.
Yeah,
you know, right. I deserve. Bob needs to be nicer to me. I should have my this way. I should have this. I, me, me, me. And maybe the things that I want are good, but I'm so filled with self. It's sinful, and it's a false idol. I need to tear that down. In marriage, it could be, and again, as a woman, I'll speak, you know, my husband doesn't make enough money, and he's not home enough on time, and he doesn't talk enough to the kids, and he needs to do this, and again, that's an altar that I built up that if all that was wonderful, oh, I would worship it and I would be so happy. So an examination of conscience, again, taught to us by the church, helps us get down there and find those altars and help tear them down. Number two, scripture says, and this is in 2 Maccabees chapter 10, verses 1 through 8, they destroyed the sacred precincts that were around the altar. So not only did they tear down the altar to the false gods, everything that was around it. Imagine, you know, all the bad stuff going on in the temple. So here's this altar they're doing all this bad stuff in, but there's a whole bunch of other people sitting around doing other things all around that. There's this stuff that surrounds bad. So let's say you want to be more loving to your spouse, but your neighbor is bad-mouthing your spouse all the time. Well, that's something that kind of surrounds your marriage. You might have to get rid of that neighbor, not kill them, but
thank you, Rose. Yeah.
There are things that in your life that are around you that are not good, that are pulling you away from love, that are bad influences. And friendships is one I think of, especially as women. You know, we go share our marital problems with our girlfriends, and then they tear our husbands down for us. We don't have to do it anymore. That's not good. That stuff needs to be torn down too. So number one, tear down the altars to the false gods. Number two, destroy the sacred precincts, the other bad influences that are around in other areas of your life. Number three, make a new altar. And who is that altar, Sai, for? It's for God. The one true God, the God, Jesus Christ, the God that we love, who loves us. This is, you make a recommitment. Lord, I want to love you above all. I want to be faithful in my marriage. I want to be unselfish. I commit myself again to you. And you make a new sacrifice. You worship at that altar. And if we could get into our churches, you know.
Yeah, right, right.
Frequent mass in the uniting that sacrifice that renewed sacrifice with the sacrifice of Jesus on the altar is the ideal way, but we can begin in our heart. Number four, then they, after they did this in the temple, they all fell prostrate before God and begged him not to let them fall into this defilement ever again. How many of you have ever really in your bedroom, in your living room, even in your bathroom, fall down with your body before God the next time you're praying? It's a powerful body language that moves the heart. Fall down before him and beg him for the graces to love your spouse rightly.
Yeah.
And to never let you fall into those sins that have been in your marriage again. Whatever's defiling it, get rid of it and fall prostrate before God. And then trust in his goodness. Number five is celebrate. Then Judas Maccabeus and all his followers got up and they whooped and they hollered and they had a good time. And they focused on God's goodness and his restorative love and good times to come. And they rejoiced and celebrated. So even though we have troubles in our marriage, this is a process that we can get from Scripture to purify our temple, starting with our own heart, purify our marriages, and then rejoice, celebrate.
So I love how you find these things in Scripture. I mean, to see the restoration of the temple as a model for married life, that's a real gift. And here's I want to give you, this is a hard one, but I imagine the person listening, and for a very long time in my marriage, I imagine I might have been this person, who is very attracted to what you just said and wants that for their marriage, but doesn't feel that the other person will go along with it, feels hopeless as far as whether the other person will tear down the altars and prostrate themselves before God with them and move to that new life in marriage.
That's really, really difficult. And you just do it anyway. Do it for yourself, and you do it by yourself if that's what it takes. The Lord sees, the Lord knows. He will give you graces to endure. That is a huge suffering when the person that we're supposed to be most intimate with is most far away from us in our heart as we rededicate ourselves to the Lord and to his ways. Just do it. And you have to wait and be patient. We talk about Saint Monica waiting for, 25 years for her son to come around. There are lots of saints who had to wait longer for their spouses to come around.
Right.
And you don't wait for your spouse. You wait for the result, and don't keep your focus on it. One thing that I tell people sometimes is stop praying so much for your spouse. Because that's keeping your focus on, if only he or she will change. Dear Lord, send graces, because if they would change, then they would be happy and I would be happy and blah, blah, blah. Just tell God one time in the morning, Lord, have mercy, and go about your business. You know what I'm saying? Sometimes
we're obsessing on we're waiting for that some movement in the other person, and you can't control that. Is that what you're saying?
Because if they finally change and come around to Jesus like we know they should, then we'll be happy. In the meantime, we're not happy. We've lost our serenity. So what we've really done is attached, mixed in with the good desire for them. It's two things going on. We have a good desire for their change, but we're also mixing in our desire for their change and trying to control it, manipulate it, get God to send more graces, praying 10 times throughout the day. We're not trusting God. We need to relax, pray in earnest, pray faithfully, and then let go and go do your other things in your life and be about your business and trust the Lord. He's going to do the work in your heart and the spouse's heart, not you. He's going to do the heavy lifting. And to me, that's a relief.
Yes, right. And you're right back to where we began. Unless the Lord builds the house, they labor in. Let him build it. You got to let
exactly.
him build it.
Exactly. Yeah, get out of his way. Trust him, love him. You have your own altars to tear down. You have your own interior work to do. And that should keep you busy for a long time.
Well, indeed, Rose. Tell us one more time before we have to go where people can get the books. The three that are available, A Woman's Guide to Happiness.
Happiness, Romance, and Relationships. Go to my website, rosesweet.com/store, and enjoy. The fourth one is coming out next year.
Get to work on that, Rose. Get to work.
I will.
All right. Rose Sweet, you can find her at rosesweet.com. And we did a whole entire show talking about marriage, and we didn't talk about the time your husband ate the sandwich. We didn't talk about. Oh, I wasn't supposed to mention. I apologize. Merry Christmas, Rose.
Sorry, honey. Merry Christmas to you and Missy.
and to all of our listeners, Merry Christmas to you. Thanks for joining us. We'll see you tomorrow, God willing, right here on Catholic Answers Live.